resident, an ardent pro sports fan, and a full-time writer who signed her first contract with Goldstrips Books in 2013. That novel, Stick McLaughlin, The Prohibition Years, went on to win the Golden Crown Literary Society's Debut Author Award in 2015, but as much as she loves that historical fiction genre, she's since produced three contemporary romances. Two published this year are available now during Women's Week, and both are set locally, Night Voice in Provincetown and Nantucket Rose in, obviously, Nantucket. Frizz's background is in community newspapers and telecommunications, and she devotes her time to writing as well as singing and playing acoustic guitar. She's yet to decide which matters more.
Thank you. Today I'll be reading from Night Voice. Night Voice is set in Provincetown. Came out in January. It's about a Murphy Callahan, who is a late night talk radio disc jockey here in town. And in this scene, she's left work in a blizzard at 3 a.m. and is stuck, trapped in a snowbank until Riley Burke happens to come along to her rescue in her Jeep. This is their first encounter. In the dim dashboard light, the woman's profile was all Riley could see of her face. That funky skull cap and ear flaps, grayish imitation rabbit fur, she guessed, that hid most of the woman's features. Long, graceful eyelashes tipped with drops of melted snow fluttered as she sighed. How long have you been stuck here? About an hour or so. I thought I'd see a police cruiser or a plow, but no one's come by. I can't begin to thank you, though. She extended a handshake. I'm Murphy Callahan. What's your name, please? Riley shook her hand. Riley Burke, you sit a while. I'll be back. She spun out of the Jeep, back into the gale, and spent another 15 minutes shoveling out the front end of the Volkswagen and a sizable portion of the snowbank. She connected their vehicles with industrial-strength rope and returned to the Jeep, shook off most of the snow on her body, and jumped in. The heat was oppressive, and she broke out in a sweat. She pushed her hood off and fought back a shiver. Please buckle up just to be safe. She eased the Jeep forward and crept off the banking until the rope drew taut. Inching steadily onto the street, she looked back to see the Volkswagen roll through the snow and level off. She stopped gently, turned the wheels into the banking, and set the brake. Now stay here. She hustled out and unhooked the rope, then opened the Beetle's door. Snow blew into the car and swirled around her face. She fumbled to find the ignition, but managed to turn it on and angle the steering wheel slightly toward the street. With a hand on the wheel and one braced on the open door frame, she set her boots firmly and pushed. The car resisted, and Riley eased up, then pushed again, and then repeated the actions until the rocking motion set the car free. Riley jumped behind the wheel as the Volkswagen began to move. She turned the key, but nothing happened. Silently, the car picked up speed and rolled past her Jeep. Riley turned the key again. On the third try, the engine kicked in, and she revved it up as she coasted to a stop at the bottom of the hill. She held the accelerator down slightly to keep the motor alive. She jumped when Murphy and her furry hat appeared at the window. Oh my God, Riley, you're a magician. You're supposed to stay in the Jeep. But the car's good to go now, right? It's run. I doubt this will last if I take my foot off the gas. Your battery needs a jump. As if proving her point, the car died when she stepped out. Come on, we'll bring the Jeep down and get you hooked up. Within 10 minutes, Riley had her vehicle positioned nose to nose with Murphy's, both hoods raised slightly and jumper cables transfusing life into the dead battery. Bottle of water, she produced one from a cooler behind Murphy's seat. Thanks, again. Murphy tugged off her furry hat and then gloves and stuffed them into it. She ran long, manicured fingertips through her hair and shook her head. So you've had a long night. Do you make a living rescuing people? Property maintenance. Riley gestured to the window. The winter's never been this bad. We'll probably set a record for snow. Well, then Murphy set her hand on Riley's arm. Tonight you're my knight in shining armor, Riley. There's no doubt about it. I'm glad I could help, but you gotta be more careful. She met Murphy's eyes evenly then and swallowed hard when they took hold in the poor light. They were deep and soft and narrowed when those glamorous cheekbones rose. Riley forced herself to make a point. Forgetting your phone was a big mistake. Tell me about it. Murphy brought her water bottle to her lips, and Riley watched her drink. Noted the smooth glide of her cheek, the sway of her throat as she swallowed. The temptation to touch suddenly rose from nowhere, and Riley hurried to think of something to say. Were you sleeping when I pulled up? Murphy shrugged. It seemed harmless. I mean, someone was bound to come along. Are you always so brave? Brave? Murphy laughed, a bright, spirited sound, rather out of place, considering, but Riley liked it nonetheless. Well, I wanted to say reckless. Are you? Oh, God, I'm not reckless. It was just a crazy evening, and I guess I wasn't thinking. You could have been hurt out there, you know. I know, you're right, and I'm thankful. What if you rolled over? Did you notice how close you came? Oh, trust me, I noticed. If you hadn't sunk in the snow, you would have gone right over. And there's a hell of a drop on the other side. Out here in this mess, you could have ended up unconscious for God knows how long. It's after 4 in the damn morning, for Christ's sake. Why, whoa, Murphy held up a palm. Hold your horses there, Rough Rider. I was lucky, I know, and luckier still that you arrived. I take it there's no one waiting for you? You come looking? Murphy arched an eyebrow and looked challenging and rather irritated. As a matter of fact, no. I bet you don't even have an emergency blanket in your car. Murphy turned in her seat and squared off. The dim light allowed only the side of her face to show, but Riley could tell from the keen look in one eye that she probably overstepped. As a matter of fact, I do have a blanket in the car, in the spare compartment beneath the carpet in the back, which, as you well know, I could not get to. Through the back seat, Riley countered, you could have. More than an hour in a blizzard dropped the temperature there in this so low, I'm well aware of how cold it was, thank you. I'm not an idiot. I didn't call you an idiot. Just because I don't know how to turn a car inside out doesn't make me a fool. I didn't say it did. Well, you certainly implied as much. Okay, look, I'm sorry. I'm not in the mood to argue. Neither am I. Murphy tightened the cap on her bottle. How much longer will this take? She juttered her chin toward her car. Riley adjusted her hat and pulled up her hood. This conversation was over. It should be enough. She got out and shut the door. It better be, she mumbled into the wind. She thanked God when the Volkswagen purred. Suddenly, Murphy was at the car door, her ear flaps on that funky hat loose and swinging at her cheeks. So what's the verdict? Riley nodded as she unfolded herself from the small car. They stood toe-to-toe, squinting at each other, shoulders hunched. You're good to go, but take it slow and steady. Riley stepped aside and unconsciously guided Murphy by the arm into the driver's seat. She leaned into the open doorway, blocking the storm. Don't use any accessories, just the defroster on low, if you have to. Murphy nodded at the gauges, then reached for her laptop case. I want to pay you for all you've done. No. Yes. She put her checkbook and pen on the dash and pulled off her gloves. Don't argue. Riley reached in, grabbed the checkbook, and tossed it onto the passenger seat. No. Now, do you have enough gas to get home? Murphy glared up at her. Jesus. Are you always this stubborn? Yes. Riley bent closer to check the gas gauge herself, and her cheek brushed the top of Murphy's furry hat. The faint scent of sweet spring rain reached her, a perfume seductive and welcoming, and she withdrew immediately. What did the fuel gauge read? Listen, Riley. Murphy touched her arm again, and the sensation struck her as tangibly as if her arm was I do thank you. Maybe we'll see each other around town under different circumstances. Riley thought of how wrong it was that no one was out there losing her mind, worrying, waiting for Murphy Callahan to come home. You're welcome. Yes, maybe we will. Take care now. She shut the door and backed away, back to her Jeep, where she stood in the snowy wind and stared after the disappearing taillights.